Welcome, everyone, to the last in our career lecture series on this political affairs lecture series on practical politics and policymaking. And for those of you who are enrolled in the class, next Thursday is, of course, the last day of class, and we'll have an exam on that day. And Kelly has some information on what that exam will look like and how to study for it. Okay, excellent. Thank you. Welcome, everyone. We have a large audience, and I appreciate the interest. I'm guessing the large audience is due to John Dinkelman's current job description, which is Deputy Chief of Mission at the U.S. Embassy in Nassau, the Bahamas, which everyone is, of course, thinking is the world's perfect job. And so, and he's got it, and you want it, so you've come to the right place. We're very pleased then today to have John Dinkelman with us. He has previously served as consul at the U.S. consulate in Nogales, Sonora, Mexico, with responsibility for U.S. and Mexican affairs in the northern half of the state of Sonora. And he has been with the Foreign Service Institute since 2001 and has had a variety of positions. I'll let him talk about those to the extent that he wants to. They all sound interesting and in fun places of the world, or maybe not so fun, I'm not so sure. John graduated from BYU in Provo with degrees in business and Spanish. And prior to joining the State Department, he worked for Communication Systems Division of Unisys in Salt Lake City. And so we're really pleased to have him, and we're pleased for your interest in international affairs and a foreign service career. Thanks for coming, John.
Thank you, Dan. How long do I take? Are you going to be interactive with questions?
Very much so.
Okay, but probably a total of an hour.
Okay, so I close up at 5 o'clock?
We need to close at 5, yeah.
All right, very good. Mm-hmm. And I will put this on. Hi, everybody. Oh, see, we do this. Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Yeah, wake up, wake up, wake up. So is this a class or is this a talk?
Both, yes.
A talk class. Okay.
This is a lecture series class, but then we invite in people who aren't involved in the class to hear the lectures as well.
Okay. Well, I've been asked to speak to you about career reflections, which is something they only ask old dinosaurs to do as they're about to be put out to pasture and drop dead. So, you know, that's a warm feeling, and I'll try to get over that as time goes on. How many of you have heard me talk before? Please raise your hands. So I can't repeat the lies that I've done previous because that'll just bore you, so I'll have to come up with new things. What I do on this kind of a lecture, talk, whatever we call this, over the course of an hour, is I will give you a little bit about myself, because I have always felt in every environment in which I've ever listened to somebody speak that I wanted to know more about them so that then I could judge what they had to say to me as to whether it was really credible or not. So it's 5 minutes after four. I am really going to try to quickly go through in 15 minutes what I am. And then I'm going to open it up to you to ask me what you want to know from my point of view. BYU brings me out here every year. They pay my plane ticket. They pay my hotel. They pay my rental car, for which I am exceptionally grateful for the fun week in Provo, Utah, that I get to have. They do this, I think, out of sympathy for the fact that I live in difficult places and have a hard life. My purpose behind all of this is I figure if I can keep this up for about 75 years, I will have earned every penny of tuition back from this school. And that's my big goal. So, I am a Foreign Service officer with the United States Department of State. I have been with the Foreign Service since 1988. How many of you were not even born in 1988? Thank you for making me feel really, really warm and happy right now. Back then, there was a place called Yugoslavia, and that was the first place I was assigned as a vice consul for 2 years, just as the nation slipped into civil war. And it was my opportunity to be one of the last American diplomats to cross the Croatian-Serbian border when there really wasn't a Croatian-Serbian border. And I left Yugoslavia about 1 week prior to Croatia and Slovenia declaring their independence and that nation sliding into a full bloodbath that you've probably studied now as ancient history. My second assignment in the Foreign Service was to London, England, where I was a staff assistant. Much of my time assigned to London was actually back on the Balkan in the former Yugoslavia because there was a war going on and they needed people to go back and do things who spoke Serbo-Croatian, or at least who thought they spoke Serbo-Croatian. I was in London long enough to acquire the most expensive souvenir of my life in the form of a British wife who has stayed with me through thick and thin over the past 18 years. Immediately after marrying my British wife, we left England and went for 2 years. We spent 2 years in the Republic of the Marshall Islands, 12 time zones away from her beloved England and my beloved in-laws. But I won't go into that. Because this is BYU and certain language is not allowed, dear. Anyway, and so we spent 2 years as newlyweds in the Northern Pacific in Micronesia, where I was the regional administrative officer in charge of the United States embassies in the Marshall Islands and the Federated States of Micronesia. After those 2 years, we were reassigned for 4 years to the American Embassy in the Netherlands, where we lived in The Hague, and it was everything you picture it would be. Bicycles, tulip fields, windmills, happy, happy. We had our first 2 children while assigned to The Hague, and we left The Hague in 1999 and spent 1 year in Turkish language training in Washington, D.C., prior to moving on to Ankara, where I was the human resources officer for the American mission to Turkey, which was also a wonderful experience and a really cool country to live in. While in Turkey, our second child was diagnosed as being autistic. And so that put a real wrench in the works of life. When you have a handicapped child, how do you live overseas and meet the needs of your handicapped child? Well, in our case, we decided to pull the plug and we curtailed out of Turkey and returned back to the United States to get the special education that my son would need. And we spent the next 5.5 years in Washington, D.C., which, to my surprise, as someone who joined the Foreign Service specifically to not work in Washington, D.C., it ended up being some of the most personally and professionally fulfilling experiences of my life. The family got what we needed. We had another child who was also subsequently diagnosed as being autistic, and I had a wonderful job in the Foreign Service Institute teaching all of the new diplomats who were coming in, being hired in. I was kind of like the drill sergeant for the Foreign Service. Your first day you would come to me, and over 6 years I was the person who everybody knew as the first person they worked for before they got sent out to their first assignments. It was a wonderful job. And it was during my time at that job that people at the Kennedy Center decided to scrape the bottom of the barrel and start bringing me out here to speak to students and to jade your minds forever. But being a Foreign Service officer has some, for lack of a better word, terms and conditions of employment. One of them that you sign on for is that if you are a Foreign Service officer, you can't stay in the United States. You are a Foreign Service officer to be foreign and to go overseas. But yet I had a son who was not cleared to go overseas because of health conditions. And so it was very difficult, very hard to figure out what to do through what I still consider to be miraculous and providential acts of a loving Father in heaven. I was assigned to be the consul in, as you mentioned, Nogales, Mexico, which for those of, how many of you are from Arizona? There's no Arizonans in this room? Oh, one. Where are you from, son?
Preston.
We won't hold that against you. But Nogales is on the border, 60 miles south of Tucson, and because of its location, my child could be cleared because there would be adequate special education in Arizona, but I could still get overseas again, if but by a few miles, to serve my country, abroad, if Sonora is truly abroad. Those of you from southern Arizona know it's like your backyard. After four brilliant, wonderful years of being the consul in northern Mexico, I had the, again, miraculous opportunity to be selected to be the deputy chief of mission at the American Embassy in the Bahamas, which similarly happened to have a school that would be willing to accommodate my two autistic children and deal with their needs while allowing me, this time by 100 miles, to get a chance to be overseas once again. The interesting thing about American diplomatic institutions and organizations, many of you already know that many times the Americans will designate someone who is not a diplomat, a career diplomat, to be an ambassador. This is particularly true in the nicer places around the world. You're not going to see career foreign service officers going to London, Paris, Rome, or Nassau, but rather these people will be receiving the benefit of having supported the president's campaign efforts or donation efforts or whatever the case might be. These are truly the personal representatives of the United States, of the president of the United States. Whereas in more difficult places or war zones or less desirable locations, you'll see career foreign service officers as ambassadors. Well, in places that are very desirable, the job of being the deputy chief of mission is very important because that is a career foreign service officer who knows the ways, the protocol, the organization, how to get things done, and how to maximize the effect of having a personal friend of the president, in many cases, always an associate and supporter of the president, in that location as ambassador, and molding the political and the organizational together into one. And so it has been a very, very interesting 3 months for me that I have been on the ground in the Bahamas with a wonderful politically appointed ambassador who I will say in front of anyone has been by far the best ambassador I've ever worked with. Her name is Nicole Avant, and she was part of the campaign in 2008 that got President Obama elected. However, it was with great angst that she brought me into her office about 2 months ago and informed me that she was resigning. And so last Monday, Ambassador Avant left me. I still feel the pain of her leaving me and abandoning me, and basically left me with the keys of the embassy in the Bahamas. I am overwhelmed by the prospect of running an American embassy for the duration of the absence of an ambassador. So I'm no longer the deputy chief of mission. I'm what's known as the chargé d'affaires, the French term basically meaning the guy left holding the bag. And so until President Obama in his first administration chooses a new personal representative to send to the Bahamas, or President Obama in his second administration after the election chooses to do so, or President Obama's opponent chooses to designate a personal representative to the Bahamas, I'm the one running the bilateral relationship between us and our often forgotten third neighbor. not counting Cuba, which we don't have a relationship with, so we won't count that one for now. It's an interesting dynamic. The reason why I come out here to talk to you folks is not really to try to change your mind that you should consider becoming a Foreign Service officer. I leave that to you to make up your mind after prayerful consideration, after thought, maybe after something whispers in the back of your mind or in your heart that this might be something that you should do. And if that is the case with you, and you follow that inclination, or dare I say inspiration, then I will be one of many Foreign Service officers who will be ready to provide you with all the information you need to see yourself through to that possibly God-given inspired goal of joining the Foreign Service. Whether it be of the American Diplomatic Corps, or for those of you who are not Americans, of the Diplomatic Corps of your home country. Because I strongly feel that the more BYU graduates we can get into the diplomatic corps of their nations, the better it will be for this world. So that's where I'm coming from. LDS, 50 years old, Foreign Service officer, Army brat background, been in for 20 some odd years, husband of a foreigner, parent of a couple handicapped kids, just trying to make his way into the world, who through a prime example of the Peter Principle has been brought up to a position of relatively high importance within his organization. For the life of me, I can't figure out why they would do that, but that's the way it is. And I'm here to answer your questions and to give you some little vignette into what life is like from this side of the career path that will hopefully help you guide yourselves to whatever goals should be ahead of you in life. All right? So with that, I'm going to open up for your questions, because I'm the type of person who, when you ask me a question, I'll go off on a tangent and it'll require you to bring me back into the original subject. So there's a microphone, and since this is being recorded, we'll want you to tell me your name, what your major is, your social security number, and we'll go from there. We've got someone here in the front, and then we'll just pass it back.
My name is John Harris. I'm a IR major.
Hi, John.
Hi.
Where are you from?
I'm from Ashland, Oregon.
Ah, beautiful country up there.
I am curious. I read on the State Department website that you need to choose a cone or a track when you, and they say that it's the most important decision that you make in your career right there. You have to decide one of the four or five. I'm wondering if you can explain the difference between the political officer track and the diplomatic, and just maybe the what those jobs entail.
Okay, well, let me back up a bit and explain everything about it, and then I'll go into my take on career tracks, or cones, as we'd like to call them. Try to picture an hourglass. If one's career in the Foreign Service could be diagrammed, it would be like that of an hourglass, perhaps with a longer neck. In that all officers, while entering the examination process, have to state at the beginning whether they would prefer the political, the economic, the consular, the public diplomacy, or the management tracks. And once you decide, you're stuck. That's why they give you this, it's the most important decision you're ever gonna make in your life, right? Because it is a pressure-filled decision that once you go down one path, you cannot easily go back and go down another. It's just not easily done. But whatever track you choose as you go through the examination process, when you enter the Foreign Service, you have to do the same certain things. You have to serve in a consular assignment, because after all, no matter what our jobs are, in the end, we are there to serve the needs of the American citizen. And when war breaks out, we don't care about public diplomacy or about economic reporting, or even about contracts. We care about getting American citizens to safety. and making sure their needs are met. And the only way we can assure that we have a core of people who have that basic uniform skill, no matter what they are, is requiring them to do a tour of duty as a consular officer, to have those basic skills for the rest of their career. That must take place before one is tenured into the service and accepted for the full length of a normal career. But it is also prior to tenure where an individual, no matter what their cone, their career track, could actually get experience in other tracks. Some would argue that that's a negative, because if you've chosen something you don't like and you get to see something that's wonderful, what's the old adage, may you be dead and in heaven for 5 minutes before the devil knows that you've died? You know, there's that outlook that, gee, maybe I really like that and I've chosen the wrong thing. My attitude is rather fatalistic. Choose what you feel would be good, get a taste of anything you possibly can, but then once you're tenured, you enter that long neck of that hourglass where you have to demonstrate proficiency and competence within your skill code, within your cone, for lack of a better term. And then as you finish in the mid-levels and you look at the senior ranks of the Foreign Service, you've demonstrated competence. And the organization feels that, yes, you've been a great public diplomacy officer, but no matter what your cone, once you reach a certain level, you're expected to be proficient in everything. And it, kind of upper management, the idea that whatever you came from, you're now managing people to do the job. The old frustration of any career path is that once you're good at doing what you do, you then become the mentor and instructor for people who actually do the stuff you like, and you're just managing people more than anything else after that. It's the problem we all face if we're good enough. So that's, did I answer your questions? Okay, good. Who's next? Who's got the mic? Okay, that answers that.
Hi, I'm Troy Anderson, majoring in international relations as well.
And where are you from, Troy?
Colorado Springs.
Oh, good job.
Yeah, I like it. So Yugoslavia and then England, you've been in Turkey, DC, Mexico, and Pacific Islands.
Don't forget the Marshall Islands and Holland.
Yeah, Marshall Islands, that's right. That's a lot of diversity of culture, of language, of assignment. What can you tell us about adjusting to the different assignments? You know, how do you do with the language? How do you do adjusting to the different cultures? Does that affect you? What thoughts can you give us on that?
It affects me greatly. And I, early in life, I was a military brat. And so I moved around a lot as a kid. And I was not one of those who the military likes to think of when they think of their kids. I didn't adjust well. Doing things, it was hard to be the new kid in school. It was difficult having a new bedroom, and I really liked things the way they were. Really odd that I would choose this career after all of that. But as I grew, as I served my mission, as I found out that through making myself uncomfortable with the unfamiliar, I actually became better, and I was a better person for pushing my envelope constantly, of never being complacent with the same stuff, because for me, therein lie death. I would become lazy, lackadaisic, and frankly, I would probably go inactive in the church were it not for the fact that I always had the challenge in front of me of reaching out and becoming more than I could normally. And so, no, the adjustment wasn't, and I don't think it's ever become easier. It's the old adage that if you do it more, your ability to do it becomes greater. It's hard. And I think as one ages, the ability to bounce back from change is even more challenging. But all that being said, the benefit from having those experiences and having the opportunity to both affect and be affected by many different people of many different cultures it's the crowning bit of the career, in that you get to do this and they pay you, right? And they give you little teeny license plates that say you're special. right? You know, it's a real neat way to go through life if you have the ability to cope with such erratic change and unpredictable change. Let's continue. Young lady, you choose those who will ask because you've got the mic. Yeah.
Hi. My name is Emma, and I'm a poli sci major.
And where are you from?
I'm from San Francisco.
Where in San Francisco?
The city.
Where? Did you go to church on 22nd and Lawton?
Well, let's see. We went to the Bay Ward.
I was baptized in the San Francisco Ward in 1969 when my dad was assigned to the Presidio.
Oh, so, very cool.
Paisan, yeah, we're cool.
Can you just tell us, like, if and where you went to grad school and about the Foreign Service Test?
Do you think I have the ability to make it to grad school? Absolutely not. I was lucky that BYU didn't kick me out before I got my bachelor's degree, young lady.
Well, about the Foreign Service Test then and that process and getting in and things like that.
I am living proof that the principle of just marking B when in doubt can sometimes work. No. I still marvel. The greatest miracle, aside from finding my dear wife, the greatest miracle was me ever getting into the Foreign Service. It was something I knew was right, and I relied on the help of the Lord to get in. So do not do as I, well, yeah, do as I do, but I mean, you're all smarter than me, so you don't need the help of the Lord to get in. You guys will do it just like that, right? No, in all seriousness, possibly because I am one of those who did not have the highfalutin degree or the extensive overseas experience, that the input you're going to get from me is going to be very fatalistic. It's going to be very laissez-faire in that, one, I'll repeat, if the Spirit is whispering to you that this is a career you should pursue, you should pursue it. Case closed, right? Two, if you feel you need to cram for the examination process of the Department of State because it contains stuff in it that isn't naturally your kind of stuff, then maybe it's not the career you should follow either. Not that I'm trying to dissuade anyone from considering the career, it's just that people who live a more insular life, who are not interested in what's going on over that mountain, much less in Azerbaijan right now, probably aren't going to be really comfortable among a lot of people who do and who will always be looking for what there is to learn from other places. My dear brother, whom I love dearly, but who, of course, up until age 21, I would have strangled if I had the opportunity, right? When I got this job, my brother looked at me and he said, Johnny, why would you ever want to go anywhere that didn't have a Taco Bell, right? And though that makes for a great bidding strategy within the Foreign Service, it kind of exemplifies the difference between me and my brother, who lives here on the Wasatch Front and with whom I enjoy an excellent relationship, as long as he doesn't bug me. But if you're not inclined to look outside of your culture, your society, your religion, yourself, for options and things to learn, then this is definitely not a career for you. But if you are predisposed, and usually folks who like come to this building sometime during their college career are not that way. You are individuals who have a predisposition for this kind of stuff. And so my advice on the examination process is just to take the stupid thing, because the worst that's going to happen is you'll fail it, right? But that doesn't close the door. It means that you failed the first time, and you might fail the second time. The best-looking diplomats fail at least three times, trust me, right? So advice or pointers from me, no. There's a diplomat in residence who is assigned to Arizona State, who has Utah under his responsibility, who comes here frequently. And the Foreign Service Student Organization is plugged into that guy. Who here is from the FSSO? Who's running this? Okay. You guys know when this guy comes, he'll do those practice tests, he'll give you the pointers, he'll tell you what to read. My opinion, take the test. because it's not like you're going to fail the class if you fail the test. Become one with failure, because in the Foreign Service, you will encounter a lot of experiences that may push you to failure, and learn to make that failure into the ultimate success that you want it to be. Kind of like a microcosm of life. Sorry, I couldn't give you a better answer.
Right, I'm Brian Oddie. I'm an exercise science major, and I'm from Kona, Hawaii.
Kona?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, why would you ever leave Kona?
The mountains are pretty sweet. Good snowboarding up here.
Oh, like man. So, and you're in what major?
Exercise science. Exercise science. I'm just really happy to be here.
That is not my field, trust me.
That's fine.
Go ahead.
I was curious, could you tell us more about the diplomatic relations between us and the Bahamas, or if you have any concerns between any of the countries that you've previously been to and our relations?
Wow. Well, I'll peel that onion. Okay, let's talk about the Bahamas first.
Thank you.
I have never worked in a nation that has been, that has enjoyed such a warm, steady bilateral relationship as I have seen in the past months in the Bahamas. I think part of this is simply the geographic reality of the Bahamas. If you put yourself into the head of a Bahamian who in all probability can trace his or her family tree back to Georgia, Florida, South Carolina, North Carolina, to 1776, when they said, no, we will be loyal to the king, and we'll go to the nearest colony that is not in rebellion. And so they jump across the water, and then land in the Bahamas. So there's that historic link. You also are sitting in the Bahamas. There's only 350,000 of you. You look to the south, and you see Haiti. And while it's a nice neighbor, it certainly is not a role model for your country. You look to the southwest and you see Cuba, see above. You know, it's you don't want to have a bad relationship with Cuba, but you certainly don't come from a similar background, and you value the ties and the roots that you have in Anglo-Saxon law and order. And I mean, you've been a British colony until 1973, and you look west and there's Miami, where you go shopping every month anyway. And where you are socially and culturally more adept at functioning and interacting. And then you see the fact that you've got 5 million people who are jumping into your country every year, 4 million of whom are coming from the United States. And so the reality is that you are inextricably linked to the United States on many different levels. And you're probably gonna send your kids to college there. And it's just, it's an absolute amazing situation, which I've never encountered before, and it's quite enjoyable. I went to an event just last week where the Prime Minister was hosting a volunteerism thing, getting people out to volunteer, you know, do what Mormons naturally have to do at least once a week, you know, go out and help someone to read or teach a class or do something. And as he was talking, and as the various leaders of the government we're talking about success stories of Bahamian society, all of those stories involved baseball teams going to the United States and staying with a family in North Carolina that said these kids are great, or you know, other sports teams going to things in Orlando, or people succeeding and going to college in the United States as a result of other people's efforts. It was everything that was good had a link to the United States. As a diplomat, I mean, this is a dream come true. You know, I didn't hear anybody in the Bahamas in that meeting, or I haven't heard anyone say, those Americans, they have ruined us, right? There is a concern about cultural inundation. No kidding, 350,000 people next to 300 million. You should guard your culture and do everything you can to foster it. But in this global society that we've got, the interaction has been brilliant. Okay, so that's answering your first question. Now, what was it about all those other places I've served?
Well, I was just curious if there is any place that you're concerned about U.S. ties. It looks like we have pretty good ties with the Bahamas now, or at least now I know that.
Knock on wood. Yeah.
relations kind of fractured or stressed at this time?
Oh, I think as put yourself, I mean, most of you probably go to a student ward. 3 months ago, you had relationships with a set of, say, five people. This month, would you say your relationships with those different five people have changed and altered ever so slightly? Right? Probably. And in the same way that individuals continue to evolve and move on, countries do the same thing. Our relationship with the Marshall Islands now is undoubtedly very different than our relationship was with the Marshall Islands 15 years ago when I was there. Is that good? Is that bad? I don't know. It would, you'd have to ask the Marshallese what they think. Nations are always going to act in their self-interests. I mean, I could probably talk for an hour on how Turkey has changed in the past 10 years from when I was last there. But the reality is that our relationships with all the nations to which I have been assigned, fortunately, remain strong, dynamic, and I dare say very stable. I mean, our relationship with Britain is constantly called into question as this unique, special relationship. I don't doubt that people will continue to examine that term for years to come, because it's one that always merits examination. I think when we take it for granted is when we are most at risk. Okay.
Thank you.
We'll see where she chooses. It's like the roulette table.
My name is Ruth, and I'm a public relations major, and I'm actually just from Orem, so
good.
Not too far away. It's kind of a divergence from what we've been talking about, but what do you think the role is of cultural diplomacy, and have you, in your engagements in different countries, ever engaged in particular cultural exchange programs?
Me personally, no. The role of cultural diplomacy is huge. It is an unmined treasure trove, which if utilized appropriately, I feel will give us benefits for generations to come. Our greatest assets around the world are individuals who are not from our country who come here to be educated. And I know that's not necessarily cultural, but I'll get to that. How many of you are foreign students? Okay. I dare say that when you go back, forgive me, what country are you from?
I'm from Guatemala.
Okay. When you go back to Guatemala, right, you will have such a deep understanding of the United States in comparison with other Guatemalans. You will know what is bad in this country. You will know what is good. But the critical thing is that you will know Americans. And you will know when you turn on the television in Guatemala and you see whatever the crappiest TV program is we put out, some whatever it is that MTV will send to Guatemala, you will know that that is not America, but that is simply television from America. Whereas millions of people will never understand that. So the ability of personal diplomacy, of individual interaction, is immense. Mormon missionaries going overseas are such an asset for the United States. Not necessarily because they portray the United States. They portray a very, very distinct and small portion of the United States. But through them comes a vignette of America that hundreds of thousands of people will not otherwise know. Cultural exchanges are the same. They're just done on a much more organized basis, in which individuals, because of interests or because of whatever focus they may be undertaking, have the opportunity to share. Similarly, both coming to this country and leaving this country. If I could budget our budget, I would triple or quadruple the amount of money we put into getting people feet on the ground in other countries or bringing people to this country, so that in the end, when a question comes up as to what action we should take against the United States, there would be a core of people who would say, no, I know America, we want to do it this way to make sure that things go right. So.
Thank you. My name is Aaron, and I'm an Italian major. I'm
from where?
From Maryland.
Where in Maryland, son?
Bowie.
Bowie.
Yeah.
Very good.
I'm interested in a career as an FSO. I've looked into it a bit, and I've taken the aptitude test. I didn't like the test. If this would work for you,
right?
And I was good on all marks except for I had a deal breaker about would I be okay if I was sent to if I was assigned to an area that my family couldn't come as well, and I would be assigned for who knows how long without my family. And I said no, I wouldn't be okay with that. And they're like, deal breaker, don't do this job. Do you second that?
Yes, I agree. There's nothing more important than your family.
Is it how often does that happen in a career, in a lifetime career? Has that ever happened to you?
No, no, it has not. And I joined a foreign service that is very different from the foreign service you will be joining. I was never told I would need to, besides I was single, so I didn't really care at that point. But I was never told that I would need to expect to separate myself from my family for at least one tour. And so it was never part of my reality. And now at this point in my career, it's still not a part of the reality, because I suspect that my wife and I would come to a prayerful decision that I would leave the Foreign Service before I would leave my family. But that's the decision we have made. And we've gone into it eyes wide open as it presented itself. The reality is different for you. Are there Latter-day Saints in the Foreign Service right now who, even this year, there are people we know, other people in this room who know parents right now, who are, dad is sitting in Iraq and mom is sitting in China, waiting to go on to the next assignment. And that undoubtedly will be a tremendously challenging year for both husband and wife. Some families are up to it, some families are not. If the Foreign Service is anything, it exacerbates pre-existing conditions in families and individuals. If you are a strong, tight, supportive family, the Foreign Service will probably strengthen you and make you even more supportive of one another. If there are problems in relationships, the Foreign Service will make them worse. And so, yeah, it's right. In your case, if you unilaterally say, no, I will never leave my wife and kids, then it's definitely not the career for you. Because if it presents itself, you're going to have to leave. A similar argument can be made about the military. And in a way, the Foreign Service of the 21st century is making more military-esque demands on its people. So yeah, nothing's more important than that family. She's got the mic over there, guys. You got to get her, you got to wink at her and promise her something, and she'll bring the mic over next.
I'll do your abstract.
Ooh, she's there.
Hi, my name is Jared Dyer, and hi. I'm an international relations and Japanese major from Japan.
You're from Japan?
I lived there for 8 years.
Wow, where in Japan did you live?
Hokkaido, up north.
Wow, cool.
And I had a question. I wanted to know, you said you served an LDS mission.
I did. Whether or not it was really an effective mission is room for argument. I was a lousy missionary, but yeah, I did make it through.
I was just wondering where you served on your mission.
Argentina.
How knowing a language affects becoming a Foreign Service officer and where you'd be stationed or sent.
We like people to have language abilities. We will give extra points for languages on the testing process. We'll give a lot of extra points for people who speak really hard languages that we want, like Arabic and Hindi and Korean. Maybe Japanese is still on that list. I'm not sure. But the bottom line is that if you don't speak a foreign language, don't worry about it, take the test. If we send you someplace, we will make sure you have all of the skills necessary for the job we send you to. that includes language. And we'll send you to language school and we'll teach you whatever the language need is. Now, if you have Japanese abilities and you join the Foreign Service, the organization would be foolish to not take advantage and save the money of teaching you what you already know. That's going to happen. Provided, of course, you bid on jobs in Japan and you want to go back to Japan. We will capitalize on whatever you will let us capitalize you for. Okay? So, are you guys getting her now? Mm-hmm. Okay, that abstract. The guy offered you the abstract. You ought to get him next.
Hi, my name is Evan Priest. I'm from La'i'i, Hawaii.
Ah.
And I am a political science and French double major.
Great.
And I just had a question for you about what you see the role of globalization, both economic and political, in like how that will change relations between the United States and other countries. Because I had an uncle who was in the Foreign Service, and he did the economic side of it. He did economic reporting. And he lived in places like India and Honduras and Saudi Arabia. So he saw a whole bunch of different things. And he was actually in India when they were doing a lot of economic reforms. And a lot of that had to do with, you know, the more global integration of like financial systems and corporations and things like that. So I just wanted to see what your view on that was.
Okay, I hope I answer your question. Because you're asking me a lot of stuff that I simply have no idea of. But I'll give you an example from my own life and how I realized maybe I wasn't so stupid after all. In about the 1970s, maybe the 1980s, a political candidate, and I can't remember which candidate, but I remember it was a presidential election. And in a debate, the candidate said, in 1945, the United States held 85% of the world's manufacturing power, and we are now down to, you know, 63% of the world's manufacturing capability, or whatever the number was. And he was obviously trying to say that, you know, everybody else is going to make America fall apart and I'm going to be the candidate that you should vote for. And I sat there and I thought, well, no duh. You know, the rest of the world had been destroyed in 1945, and part of the goal was to help them up. So we are going to lose our percentage because we want them to stand up again. And I realized at that point, and nothing has really dissuaded me from this since then, that it's all in how you look at what you want out of a globalized world. And the more insular, the more paranoid you are, the less you're, I don't know how many of you were in this lecture yesterday about power and relative power, but magnificent in the conclusion that you're always going to be against things if you take the tack that anybody else's gain is your failure, right? And I think we continue to see this in the United States, of this fear that jobs leaving this country mean that we cannot create more better jobs. You know, there's this lack of ability to see the larger picture, that short-term pain from our own inefficacy at something does not mean that we are necessarily headed downhill, but simply as an impetus for us to do what we do best even better. And so, how do I see globalization in the future? I see America reacting to globalization and succeeding only as well as America can do if America recognizes that America's strength does not lie in being better than other countries, but constantly being better than itself. And without getting domestically political, which is one thing that Foreign Service officers don't do, I kind of fold myself into the Mormonism that has been mine ever since my birth, in that, well, you're a Hawaiian. What is the motto of your state? The, come on. The wealth of the land is perpetuated in righteousness, right? Wonderful, right? And essentially, that's what we are. You know, I'll go back to the Book of Mormon. I'll throw it into modern politics whenever we need to. And I will say America's, you know, Tocqueville. I America is great as long as America's good. And so we have nothing to fear if we simply hold to the core values and precepts which have seen us through the past 220 years. Okay. She has to get her abstract done.
What has been your...
What's your name?
Oh, yeah, sorry.
Yep.
I'm Alex. I'm from Houston, Texas. I'm a political science major.
And be it known that you're writing her abstract.
No, I'm not, but it was a way to get her attention.
Oh, okay.
he looks scared. Dr. Hawkins would kill me, but it was a way to get her attention.
It was.
Anyway, my question is, how is your career with a diplomat? Have you had the opportunity to interact with the church as in a diplomatic capacity, and with the church's relationship with other countries and missionaries and that? What? And could you elaborate on that a little bit?
Yes and no. No. It's been really enjoyable to be a resource for church leaders over my different assignments. It has been a pleasure to support the church's efforts in working with local government officials or national officials, both in and out of Washington, to accomplish whatever needed to be done. It has been even more enjoyable to work at the local level, supporting missionaries, helping them out, and expediting their work. I consider it probably the crowning part of my career, the stuff that was not done from 9 to 5. The line I kind of use for this, folks, I am a Mormon. I will be a home teacher for the rest of my life because that's what Mormons do, right? And I've just had the cool experience to be able to home teach on coconut mats, to be able to home teach going down frozen canals, to have secret police tail me as I go home teaching, to ride the subway to get to two lines, to get to the single mother in the middle of a project in a big city. And I've had the opportunity to home teach in suburban Washington, D.C. But no matter what, my life will be home teaching, right? The biggest challenge of the last 3 months that I've had has been a seminary class of 13 kids, you know, who I will be 12 if one kid doesn't shut up in the next week. But my life is preset. I am a Mormon. I will do the stuff that Mormons do. I just have the opportunity to do it in a different, exotic setting. And, you know, instead of my kids being a bunch of teenagers from suburban Salt Lake City, I've got 10 Afro-Caribbean kids with varying levels of literacy, of experience in the church. Half of them are illegal Haitians, right? And I have this tremendous opportunity to help them.
Thank you. This is scary.
It is, isn't it?
My name is
Yulia. Try wearing one. Yeah.
I'm Yulia. I'm from Ukraine.
Wonderful.
I guess I have two questions. The first one is how easy it is for women in foreign service. And the second one is, what do diplomats do? Could you explain, describe a day if you
sure.
What you guys do?
Sure. I mean, first off, not being a woman, my answer is going to be incomplete. I will be more than happy to put you in touch with a female Foreign Service officer who can tell you the truth. I am going to go out on a limb, and I'm going to say that your average female diplomat encounters the same challenges, the same problems, and the same rewards that your average female in any profession would encounter in comparison to her male counterpart. And that depending on the society in which she finds herself, she is either taken at face value and esteemed equally, or to a varying degree is lessened because of misogyny or prejudice or simply cultural restrictions that she must get through. I don't mean to belittle that. I don't mean to minimize it. But frankly, you're a woman. You're already going through this. You already have the additional burdens that I will never know. I do know that God is just and gives you the tools that you need to overcome those, right? So out of ignorance, I tell you, I'm sorry, I can't tell you more. I do know that in the American Foreign Service, we have made great strides to make sure that women are valued and given full opportunities. We're at parity at the lower ranks because we hire roughly 50% females in all of our classes. This is a goal of our organization. It may be different in the Ukrainian diplomatic corps. I probably think it would be, because I do not think the Ukrainians are at the same level of gender parity that we would like to believe we are at in the United States. So I'm really answering you blindly, but I would not place gender as a restriction for you to pursue a career in diplomacy. There are far too many excellent examples of female success in the profession of diplomacy from virtually all nations to allow that to excuse you from considering this career. Now, you asked about women. Now, what was the other thing you asked about?
It was a day-to-day experience.
Okay. That's a real general question. Let me just give you a general example. The vast majority of time that one in the diplomatic corps in general spends in your business day, particularly early in an assignment to a given country, is reactive, reactionary, learning the lie of the land and reacting to it. It's almost the learning curve is exceptionally steep, but it is continuous. And whatever your specialty may be, learning the interlocutors, understanding the cause and effect of things within that country, and negotiating one's way around the new environment draws a lot of your energy in the beginning of your assignment. Ironically, as you become better at that, acclimated linguistically, socially, culturally, mentally, whatever the need might be that you will have adjusted, ironically, you usually become very, very good just as it's time to leave. Because along with that proficiency comes a love for the place where you are. And your lens changes to look at something with a local point of view. And in a way, a very counterproductive way, you become more of an advocate for that place than you do for your own country. So you leave and you go someplace and you start that all over again. In another 2.5 years, I will be very Bahamian, to the point where people in Washington may say, "No, Dinkelman, you got to get out of there because, you know, you're about ready to naturalize and just stay there for the rest of your life." Same thing happened to me in Mexico and in every one of the countries in which I've been assigned. Not necessarily because you become a convert to the country and you disavow America, but rather your point of view becomes so central to that location that you're no longer looking at the wider picture that an American diplomat should be looking at. So there's a fine balance.
So